The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Okay, hello everyone. My name is Jim Farnsworth and I am a systems engineer here at TSI, and we'll be talking about TSI's next generation SMPS. I was on the project team that completed this redesign. We completed it last year, and we've been shipping these instruments since October. Maybe somebody could, from one of my TSI friends on the line, could just send me a chat message, let me know that audio is coming in. If you're tuned in, you should be able to see a screen right now that says title of the broadcast, TSI's Next Generation SMPS, with a pretty picture on the front of the classifier sitting beside a CPC. All right. Well, I'm just to kind of let you know what's going to happen here. I'm going to spend pretty much the full hour on this presentation. I think the first 45 minutes will be, I'll give the presentation, and then we'll leave about 15 minutes for Q&A at the end. When we get to the Q&A at the end, you can send me your messages via the chat message box down at the bottom. You have something off on the right-hand side of your screen, and you can enter in questions through that. And you can send me questions throughout the presentation. I might not be able to get to them until the end, though, just to let you know. Let's see what else. You'll be getting a presentation sent out to you, probably in a PDF format, after the broadcast, and so you have a copy of this material. Okay, just an outline of what we're going to talk about. I'll give some background and motivation for this redesign, and I'll cover at least 5 minutes of theory on SMPS for those of you who are less familiar with what's going on inside of a classifier and a DMA. We'll spend the majority of our time talking about the new features of the new classifier and SMPS. Talk a little bit about verification, validation, and robustness testing, and some applications and questions. Okay, differential scanning has been the measurement principle of choice for many years for making size distribution measurements of aerosols, and TSI has been providing instrumentation to make these measurements since 1972. Shown on the right here is the TSI model 3071, which undoubtedly some of you still have in your labs. I see them showing up in presentations and posters still. It's a very robust instrument still out there, but it was a little tricky to use because of the careful flow balancing that was necessary. And it was in 1999, the TSI redesigned that in the form of the TSI 3080 classifier, which is shown here, and that was a great improvement over the 3071, and has really been a staple in the aerosol world and in labs across the globe. We see dozens of papers and presentations using this instrument each year. So come 2012, we're looking back, and it's been, you know, almost 15 years since we had done that last generation. And since then, CPCs have fast response time, electronics are faster, and there is multiple reasons that we should, you know, undertake a refresh of this project, of this product. So. But I guess the design team needed to have the mindset that, you know, the 3080 performance was well proven, and we must not do any harm. The redesign must be as good or better. And so we spent a lot of time on reliability. We spent significant more time on this product than some of the others that were in the pipeline, just because we knew that we had such a big customer base, and we were not up for disappointing anyone. So. With that being said, we had a very innovative product that came out of this and reliable out of the gate. So here's just kind of an overview of those features of the TSI model 3082 classifier shown here, and we'll go into more detail about it later in the presentation. Main features are faster scanning. So now instead of having to, traditionally scan time 30 seconds is typical, we can scan down much quicker than that now, or scan up. Much quicker than that now. Sheath flow was improved to a higher sheath flow capacity. We now auto-recognize all the SMPS hardware. In fact, you can install the DMA, CPC, neutralizer, impactor without the use of tools. With a SMPS, as you know, it's a very modular device, and it's nice to be able to reconfigure classifiers, installing a different DMA or neutralizer or whatever, or impactor. We can actually do that now within 60 seconds, totally reconfigure a classifier, because there is no use of tools, and things like the DMA snaps in now instead of sliding in and needing to use a flathead screwdriver to pry it out. As you can see, the weight has been reduced, the width has been reduced, so it's a tighter footprint than it used to be. We support standalone scanning, which means now you no longer need a computer sitting beside it to run an SMPS scan. You can do this from the front panel. It's controlled, and you can set it up completely from the front screen. But in addition, we do still support AIM software, and in fact, we upgraded that. That was a major part of this project. The TSI model 3088 is showing up here in the corner. This is the next kind of a repackaging of the 3087 soft X-ray neutralizer, and so now it's integrated and it fits in to the classifier, although it can still be used in a standalone. Okay, a little bit about theory here. SMPS stands for Scanning Mobility Particle Sizer, and SMPS is a modular device, and it is important to understand the functions of the key components. A typical SMPS has these four components: an impactor for sample conditioning, a neutralizer for charge conditioning, a DMA to select a narrow size slice, and a CPC to count how many particles were in that size slice. The purpose of the first two stages is to put the aerosol in a condition where valid assumptions can be made about the size and the charge of the particles. Starting with the impactor, its purpose is to remove large particles, larger than a micron approximately. Large particles can cause data inversion problems since they can potentially carry lots of charge, so their mobility is less predictable. Also, large particles are going to dirty the upstream components, downstream components rather, than quicker than small particles, resulting in more cleaning and more maintenance issues. And really large particles may clog those components, and it's not unheard of to have a bug sucked in and get it stuck someplace in the system. So, impactors are often used, especially in applications where the aerosol is ambient air. A second function of the impactor is to provide a real-time measurement of the sample flow. The orifice inside of an impactor creates a pressure drop, and this pressure drop can be utilized to monitor sample flow. The purpose of the neutralizer is to define the charge distribution on the particles. Depending on where you are sampling from, whether it be ambient air or some sort of laboratory-generated aerosol, the particles might be highly charged. A neutralizer contains a radiation source, either krypton or X-ray. Both of them are shown here in the case of the TSI SMPS. Radiation from this source bombards the particles and knocks around the electrons on particles so that they resettle, and the result is that the aerosol comes out with a net zero charge. Now, that doesn't mean that all the particles are neutral. In fact, we couldn't make the measurement if that were the case. It just means that the distribution of electrons is well defined. Shown in this chart here, you can see that the majority of small particles do, in fact, come out of the neutralizer neutral. What we're counting on is this 1%, this plus 1 or the negative 1 portion, that it is proportional to the overall charge fraction. From the neutralizer, the particles pass to a DMA. DMA stands for Differential Mobility Analyzer. A DMA is a size selector. A polydispersed aerosol comes in, meaning particles or aerosol made up of multiple sizes, and a monodispersed aerosol comes out, meaning just one size, typically. In an electrical terms, a DMA is a bandpass filter, allowing only through particles of a specific size. The DMA operates by an electrostatic principle. Particles enter the DMA at top, and they are introduced to an air gap over which there is an electric field. The outer cylinder is at ground with respect to the center rod, which is held at a controlled voltage. Clean air, called sheath flow, carries particles downward, and at the same time, particles are being carried, they're drawn toward the center rod. The point at which they for each the rod depends on their mobility, which is essentially their size to charge ratio. A particle with certain mobility may exist as a small particle with a single electron or a large particle with multiple electrons. Either has the same mobility. Most of the particles will be singly charged, as we saw from the plot on the previous page, but a fraction of the particles will be multiply charged. Particles with low mobility reach the rod quickly and impact out, and particles with let me back up. Particles with high mobility reach the rod quickly and impact out. Particles with lower mobilities never reach the rod, and particles with just a very narrow range of mobilities reach a gap near the bottom of the rod, and those are the particles that make it to the CPC. You might ask, well, what happens to the neutral particles? Well, even though most of the particles are neutral particles are not used by the DMA. They are thrown away. So are particles that have the same charge as the center rod. They're repelled and lost. So there are a lot fewer particles coming out of the DMA than coming in. But that's okay because we know what the charge distribution looked like. So we can essentially back calculate how many total particles there were to start with. From the DMA, the particles go to the CPC. CPC stands for condensation particle counter. And it is just that. It counts particles. A laser counts each particle after the particle has been grown using a supersaturated vapor to a size which it is big enough to scatter light. So these three pieces of equipment together, shown here in orange, are called an electrostatic classifier. At least that's the box that houses these components. It controls the DMA sheath flow and the high voltage. If the DMA is set to a constant voltage, the system is a monodisperse aerosol generator, which people use by itself to produce submicron particles for testing and calibration or for filtering out unwanted sizes. Today, one of the main uses of the electrostatic classifier is the place it serves in an SMPS system. In the mid-80s, it became common practice to get size distribution information by stepping the voltage over the center rod one step at a time so you can get various size slices. By combining the classifier now with a CPC and counting how many particles are in each slice, you can build something called a size distribution. And those of you who are familiar with AIM would recognize something that looks like this. So that is the size distribution that we're getting out of an SMPS, telling us both size information, what size particles are, and how many of them there were in each slice. Now, stepping the voltage led to what we do now, which is continuous scanning, which shortens the amount of time it takes to get the same information. As you can imagine, there's a lot of math that goes into figuring out what size the CPC is seeing at any given moment, and this math is what we call the data inversion, typically done by software or on a PC. So in a nutshell, that's the theory of operation of an SMPS. For more information, you can refer to Appendix B of the SMPS manual if you have that, or check out the book Aerosol Technology by William C. Hines, which has a great discussion of DMAs and many other aspects of particle technology. All right, so getting into kind of what most of you are probably interested in learning about, which are the new features of this classifier. This is three screenshots of the fronts of the instrument and different modes that the classifier can be used in. The bottom and the top modes shown here are what you are used to with the 3080, not necessarily the images and the icons, but a classifier mode means your instrument is set up to be a monodisperse aerosol generator. You set a sheath flow, you set a voltage, and you get a particle diameter out. External control mode would be the same as I think we call it analog control on the 3080, where the something else is in control, in most cases AIM software, aerosol instrument manager. So we still support that. To be in that mode, you're doing SMPS scans, so a CPC is required. I guess the new mode that we have is this what we're calling SMPS mode, and that's this tab in the middle, which means does the same thing as AIM, except you don't need a computer. So you can set up and run and look at your data right from the front screen without the need for a computer. Just a closer look at what's going on there. Similar to a lot of the other TSI devices that we've put out in the last 5 years, this screen should look familiar. There's a title bar up at top that changes colors depending on the error state of the instrument. Similar to AIM, you have a y-axis and an x-axis that you can click on to get different options for weighting. So you can do number, volume, area, mass. You can change the scaling. Status bar lets you know what scan you're on, things like that. You start and stop. You can set up multiple scans, multiple scans per sample. And, of course, you can view all your setup information as well. Some limited number of statistics are shown right on the screen, but you can get more statistics if you either A, import this into AIM, or B, export from the instrument itself, which contains the statistics that you're used to seeing in AIM. data can either be exported in what we're calling inverted data or raw data. Inverted data will be DN, D-log, DP, and it will always be number weighted. So this doesn't take up a lot of room. The data inversion is done on the instrument itself, and this is what comes out in a CSV file. If you plug in your flash drive, you can export it right onto your flash drive and take it, plug into a computer. You don't need any special transfer software for that. Raw data will contain a record of every particle that was counted in every 50 millisecond chunk from the CPC. As you can imagine, that takes up a lot more room, but we use that data to import into AIM. So if you want to import into AIM to do further data analysis, you would log the raw data as well as the inverted data. Raw data can also be used for your own purposes if you choose to do your data inversion offline. Data can be saved to the instrument itself. We have 8 gigabytes of memory on the instrument, or you can save it directly to the flash drive if you prefer to do that or require more than 8 gigabytes at a time. One of the new features of the classifier is an auto recovery mode. If the classifier is sampling in SMPS mode and a power failure occurs, when that power comes back on, we will resume sampling. This is great if you have it set up to run over a week, or it's running unattended, or it's running just overnight and something happens, you got a glitch in maybe your control system in your building, and when power returns, sampling will start again. So up until now, we've been using a single charge table for determining what the charge fraction looks like when doing the data inversion. And since we introduced the TSI model 3087, we now have a soft X-ray charge fraction to account for as well. And there are slight differences between what you'll see if you're getting an equilibrium distribution from a krypton source versus a soft X-ray source. Well, we now account for this. And so there's nothing that the user needs to do, but if your neutralizer that's loaded in is a 3088, either the instrument auto-recognizes it or you select it and say specifically you're using a 3088, we will use these charge tables and we will correct for it and give you that a little bit higher level of accuracy. You can reference this presentation here. Ali Wiedensohler and his group has done a lot of work on what these charge fraction tables look like. Soft X-ray. Okay, looking kind of into the instrument a little bit, can you find the differences between the 3080 and the 3082? Really, there's not a lot of differences, and that was quite intentional. But we did change just a couple of things. Bypass flow has been removed. We removed it for a couple of reasons. One is you can still rerun bypass flow externally using a nano DMA as long as you have an external source to pull that flow from, but for the majority of our customers, it was not useful. In fact, it was a little confusing having these four ports on the side of the instrument. So we now only have those two larger 3/8 inch ports on the side of the instrument. We're running now with one blower, not two blowers. None of that kind of daisy chaining of blowers. We don't need to do that anymore. An RH sensor has been added to the sheaf flow line immediately upstream of it entering the DMA, and you can use that for your purposes if you care about RH, whether or not it's getting too high for your system. And the display is now a touch screen. The twiddle knob, as we called it, has been removed. So that's what we've been using on the most recent TSI products. Okay, I mentioned the 3088 soft X-ray neutralizer. It now replaces the 3087, and it also kind of combined the control box and the head itself. So now it's just one package. It gets its power from the instrument, so you don't have to power it externally. It auto-recognizes when you drop it in. The instrument knows what it is. And let's see, what else? I guess I should mention that if you run it in standalone mode, we do provide a power cord for it. DMAs, really no change to the internal geometry of the DMAs. What we changed was the base plate. So now when you snap it into the new classifier, it will auto-recognize. And there's a little memory chip on the bottom of the base plate of the DMA. We have an upgrade kit that does a couple of things. One is if you have an existing 3081 or 3085 DMA, this upgrade kit will provide you what you need to upgrade from the 3081 to a 3081A, which means it's compatible with the 3082. It includes a couple of new ports, some new labels, and most importantly, that base plate. It also requires that you do a little bit of rotating so the port configuration works better with the 3082. This is a picture of that upgrade guide, and the list of the packing list is pretty short. There's a couple things that we send out, but we certainly recommend that you do this to your DMA if you're going to use it with the 3082. If you choose not to, that's fine, but you'll have to manually select which DMA you're using, and you still might have to rotate some ports in order to get things to line up on the 3082. If you do not choose to do the upgrade yourself, when you send your DMA in for service, we can do it here if you request that. The CPCs, we did a firmware upgrade, not a major one, to the CPCs so that they would work with the new classifier. It increases the data sampling rate from 10 hertz to 50 hertz, so we're asking the CPC for data more often. This upgrade to the new firmware you can do yourself, and in the manual it provides instructions for how to do this, but just briefly, you can go to our website under the support tab and download this new firmware upgrade. If you do not do this, you won't be able to use it with the 3082 classifier. Shown here is the flow equalizer assembly that some of you are familiar with using. The purpose of the flow equalizer assembly is so that you can run the DMA and the CPC at different flow rates, specifically so you can run a lower flow rate through the DMA than the CPC. We provide, with the new classifier, kind of a smaller one. You can still use the old one if you like, but this one is a smaller, more compact, and actually connects to the DMA instead of the CPC. Inlet impactors, if you remember, the 3080 has three nozzles that you change out, and they're connected with swage lock fittings. And there's also these two delta pressure tubes that run back to the classifier. Well, we took all that and repackaged it as part of the 3082 redesign. So now it's a quarter turn, and this nozzle pops into place. It internally is connecting to the delta pressure upstream and downstream, and so it's pretty slick. It doesn't require any wrenches or anything like that. We really like it. I'm getting a question here. How did you verify the accuracy of the size determination by the SMPS at TSI? I got that from Shoshan. I'll go ahead and answer that in a little bit. We'll get to that in about 15 minutes. So if you can hold on that question, but thank you for that question. There's a couple of them shown here. So we use the same size orifices as were used in the 3080, so that has not changed. These now have a memory chip on it, so when you snap it into place, it recognizes which one you have in. And the calibration is stored on the impactor. You don't need to marry the impactors with a particular classifier. You can take the impactors, and they can go with any classifier now. This one here is just a pass-through inlet, When you click it and push it into place, it just is a straight through. There's no impactor in place. And if you run the instrument without any impactor in place, that's fine too for ambient measurements. Okay, in some localities, it's very important to the government or to the regulatory bodies that radiation not be leaked out above a certain level. And as you know, if you're using a krypton source, there's radiation that people are exposed to. Whether or not those levels are high enough or very high, you know, compared to other things is kind of a question of comparison. But either way, we can reduce that to a level of below 1 microsievert per hour using lead shielding. So shown here is one of my favorite pictures. You can see in this case, they were probably required to do this by law, not only shield it, but make sure that that lead and that instrument not leave the lab, so they have it chained to the desk. So as opposed to doing this, we now provide an optional accessory, which is a lead shield which drops into place around the neutralizer. So this is for use with the 3077A, which has that higher level of activity and 10 millicuries. And this weighs just under 10 pounds, so it's not as much as you think, but it's 10 millimeters of lead. So that's an option for people who either want to reduce the radiation levels or forced to do it by regulatory bodies. The communication scheme between the instrument and the outside world has changed a little bit. On the 3080, the CPC was in charge of making the measurement. It was the one that ran the show and told the DMA what voltage to be at. So now it's the classifier is in charge, and so there is no longer a coaxial cable going between the classifier and the CPC. You can use RS-232 between the two, and then either Ethernet or USB if you're using a computer with it for AIM software. If you are not, you can just run it standalone mode, and you have simply one cable that connects the two. Another way you can run the instrument if you're doing this, let's say, remotely, and you want to monitor what's going on, is connecting the classifier, the SMPS system, to your local area network via Ethernet. Then you can run AIM on your computer, even though the instrument might be 100 feet away or even miles away. So these different schemes are covered in more detail in the user's manual, but basically we can talk to the system either by Ethernet or USB, and the coaxial cable is eliminated. In some cases, you want to start or stop the classifier based on what's going on in some other process in your lab, maybe an auto sampler or something else that's turning on and off. And so we can do that based using these digital inputs and outputs. There's also so that the inputs would be receiving a 5-volt input from this external device, and the output would be saying I'm ready or I'm not ready based on the status of the instrument. If it's sampling, it's not ready, or if it's an error state. If it's sitting idle, then it's ready and it's ready to take another sample. So you can enable this external trigger with a checkbox on the property screen of the instrument. Errors and warnings. They're reported similar to, well, in AIM they're the same way as they were before. You'll see an exclamation box come up and down at the bottom. You can click on that or write or just hold your mouse over it to show what errors and status are going on. You can do a little bit of diagnostics yourself, especially if you're communicating to TSI tech support. If you go to the diagnostics screen, which is a one-button click from the main screen of the instrument, it reports a number of different settings and voltages and flow rates. And this will be useful because if there is an error state, the value which is causing the issue will turn red, and that will tell you something is not quite right with that particular value. There's an extensive troubleshooting guide as well in the appendix, or I think chapter 6 of the instruction manual. On the instrument itself, if the wrench icon comes up, you can click on the wrench icon, and that will list all the errors or warnings that are occurring. J Generally, when an error comes up, it does not prevent you from making a measurement. We want to allow you to continue to make measurements even if it's in an error state. The important thing is that you know about that error, and so we also save that in the data record. Okay, AIM software, just a couple of changes made to AIM. The screen will look, the property screen will look similar to what you're used to, but we've added a protocol files tab. What this allows you to do is set up essentially a recipe or something that you use often so that you can click on that and set your instrument up. You can have multiple protocols that you load depending on what you choose to do. Instead of having an upscan and a downscan time, we've kind of renamed these. So simply scan time and then retrace time. You do not get data from retrace time. It's simply the time that it takes to get from the end of your scan, let's say your highest voltage, and get back to the bottom again. And you don't have control over that, nor do you need to have control over it. We also provide a purge time, so you can adjust this if you're seeing carryover from your previous scan. This is where you'd enter in kind of a wait period before your next scan starts if you're doing continuous scanning. ACTRIS is, I think, an initiative in Europe where there's a certain amount of data that is needed to consider a data set valid, including what lab you were in, who the user was, things like that. And so you can actually export in an ACTRIS format if this is something you choose to do. S80 is now S82. That's just a kind of a slight difference of the naming. We do not support with the new AIM version the old SMPS. So we can view, you can view old files, you can analyze and export old files, but you cannot run a scan using AIM 10 and 10.1. If you need to continue to run the 3080 or the old SMPS 3936, you'll need to have both AIM 9 and AIM 10 on your computer at the same time. And that isn't a problem. We allow for that. You can have those two simultaneously on your PC. So just briefly, here's a feature set comparison. AIM gives you more flexibility for data analysis and data export. In standalone mode, meaning running a scan from the instrument itself without the use of a computer, you can export it into AIM to kind of open up all these features, but just in standalone mode, for example, you can't view previous scans, you can't view raw counts in standalone mode, and you can't export individual scans, samples. You take data and then you get it onto a flash drive and you export all of it at once, you delete all of it at once, and things like that. You can view it with different units and weights, but you can't export it with different units or weight. It's always exported in DN, D-Log, DP, unless you're exporting raw data, which means you're taking it into AIM anyways. One thing that the standalone mode does have is the auto recovery, which is a neat feature for those who are in the situation where their instrument might freeze up overnight, it might experience a power glitch overnight. Okay, I'm going to talk a little bit about what you will expect when you get your instrument from TSI in terms of a calibration certificate. What you did get with the 3080 was a single sheet showing a sheath flow calibration, bypass, and then the three impactors. We are now fully NIST traceable and ISO 15900 compliant. ISO 15900 is a 2009 ISO standard governing the testing of mobility spectrometers, meaning SMPS systems. And we chose to follow the recommendations of that standard. What this results in is really a three-page certificate giving all the information that is required by that, and we give you, the customer, a lot more information about what we're doing internally for calibration. I'll step you through each page, but we won't spend much time on the certificate of calibration, but we use a PSL, 100 nanometer PSL, to verify particle size, one particle size. We report the standard and expanded uncertainty of that, so you can compare that to what we're actually making for the measurement. We do a high voltage calibration, and we report that on the certificate. We verify absolute pressure, delta pressure sensors, RH sensor, temperature sensors. We do leak checks and zero checks. We report that on the certificate, and we do a sheath flow calibration as well. Note that the sheath flow calibration, as well as the impactor calibration, can be done by you, the user, in the field if you have the appropriate measurement instrumentation. If you want to do sheath flow and impactor flow calibrations in the field, you can do that from the screen, front screen of the instrument. What you will need to have is a flow measurement device that you trust. We would recommend something that is at least plus or minus 2% accurate. Plus or minus 1% accuracy is even better, such as a gillibrator, or a TSI flow meter, which would be around plus or minus 2%. At least in the field, you can certainly do a check if you have something that's more coarse than that, but you can do those calibrations in the field. The third page of the certificate has all the particle test information on it, the zero check results. We do a number concentration accuracy check as well as a size resolution check. So size accuracy, number concentration, and size resolution, they are checked. They're not calibrated. We don't have fudge factors here. This is the SMPS is a principle that relies on primary measurement, so we do not have to do fudge factors to get these right. We check them during calibration. There's also a notes field. You might see a report of, you know, what issues were found, if any, in terms of clogging or maintenance when this instrument is returned to you if you request an as-found calibration be done during service. Impactor calibration certificate is shown here. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that, but similarly, each impactor gets its own certificate, and we do a leak check, we do a flow rate calibration, and we clean it. These are some user service items. We actually have a maintenance and service kit that you can purchase from TSI that includes a lot of the materials that are needed to do a routine calibration. The maintenance kit actually includes a flow meter as well. This is not the sort of flow meter that you can put on the front of the instrument to make measurements. This is an internal kind of OEM flow meter, but it's used internally to the instrument. It's a different flow meter than what we are using on the 3080. But it is fully calibrated, so you could do that installation yourself, and we provide instrument instructions on how to do that in the manual. Service and maintenance procedures should only be performed by a qualified service technician. We gave presentations last year at two aerosol conferences regarding the validation and performance of the instrument, and so now we're getting into this section. I'm only going to spend a very little time talking about validation and kind of performance features of this instrument just because we've covered it elsewhere. If you would like a copy of either of these presentations, I'd be happy to send you one, or you can contact the organizer of this presentation. I think the original email that you had has that contact information. We can send you one of these presentations. But just to talk about it briefly, we did extensive validation testing of this instrument, spent many months on it, and different prototype cycles, learning cycles as well, testing at different levels of development. Shown here is the instrument mounted in a HALT chamber. HALT stands for Highly Accelerated Lifetime Testing. And basically you shake the instrument or stress it using temperature, can be humidity, and certainly vibration until it breaks and you find the weak points. Once you find the weak points, you can go back, fix them, fix the weakest link, and come back, do it again, and verify that you fix those issues. So just showing here are a couple the sort of things that you find from HALT testing. Here's a crack that could develop over time that we found in the matter of one day of testing in HALT testing. We see where an inductor popped off of a circuit board. Here are shavings in a tube. And so each of these failure modes we were able to deal with by doing this sort of reliability testing. Shown here are different failures that we found with temperature on the x-axis and vibration level on the y-axis. And we found these different failures in development testing. You can see some failures down here at very low temperature, very high temperature, and over vibration. It's kind of tough to picture what, let's say, 45 G RMS is in terms of like a physical measurement, but let's just say everybody's wearing earplugs here up at this level. The highest recommended exposure limit for humans, for example, I think is around 15 G RMS for a parachute opening. So this is just high stress sort of environments that you're not going to see in the wild, but you will see in a lab, and we do this intentionally. So we can try to break the instrument, fix it, and then verify that we fixed it. Shown here are some destructive failures that were closer to the operating range that we wanted to be in. And so these specifically we went and fixed, and then we came back out and were able to expand our actual operational range to a higher vibration level. Note that in normal use, you're not going to see this sort of vibration at all. But in the narrower blue box, this is the box that we specify in the spec sheet. Please note that we can didn't see failures until much higher temperatures. Okay, we had a question about size accuracy earlier, and this kind of demonstrates, six instruments tested in validation testing and their size accuracy compared to what we expected it to be based on the PSL. Although their concentrations are different because they were tested days apart and in some cases a month apart, you can see that as far as size resolution and diameter, they really fall on top of each other. For more information on how we do this test, I would again refer you to the European Aerosol Conference that we did, as well as the AAAR presentation, which has information about the test setup. But basically, it's running into from a generator into a dryer, pre-neutralizing, and then going into the SMPS, and sometimes comparing it to a second SMPS that it's sitting beside, or a CPC as a reference. We do fast scanning on the SMPS, or at least we have the ability to do that, and shown here is kind of what you would expect to see as scan time decreases. Down to about 20 seconds scan time, you will not see significant broadening of a monodisperse aerosol distribution. But as you get down to lower sizes, you'll see a little bit of a shift in size and a little bit of broadening. The broadening is due to what we call smearing, which has to do with the particles and how they're reaching the CPC at slightly different times. And the size shift can be accounted for. You can kind of calibrate that out by adding a little bit of additional time delay to the measurement using the software. But as you can see, kind of a worst case, monodisperse distribution, you're going to see a little bit of broadening. Fast scanning is ideal for high concentrations of polydisperse aerosol. And in that case, the broadening will be almost not unnoticeable at 10 seconds and maybe even at 5 seconds. I'm just going to grab a drink of water here. Okay, so shown here is kind of what you would expect in terms of the geometric size distribution and how it increases for a monodisperse aerosol. A typical monodisperse distribution might be 1.04, 1.05 geometric standard deviation, which is a measurement of how wide that distribution is. And if we're scanning at 10 seconds, we're going to increase by about 1%. If you're scanning at 5 seconds, that's going to increase by, let's say, 3%, up to 1.07 geometric standard deviation. Now, that's not really a big deal if you are doing a polydisperse aerosol. You're already at 1.6, 1.5 geometric standard deviation. So it's really, you want to avoid fast scanning if you're doing monodisperse aerosols. This is kind of a use case of what you would see between, let's say, a 5-second scan and a 60-second scan on SMPSs sitting beside themselves, beside each other. This is an animation. I'm going to try to play it here, and hopefully you'll see what's going on. But they're sitting side by side in a room with a toaster, and we start the toaster up, and the toaster runs generates particles and increases the particle concentration in the room by a factor of 1,000. With the SMPS that is scanning at 5 seconds, we have much better resolution of what's going on. We can see kind of the ebbs and flows of the particles as they're increasing, whereas the instrument that's set up for 60-second scans, you don't get that sort of resolution. I'm going to play that again, and you can see how these build. So every 5 seconds, we get a distribution from the faster scanning SMPS, whereas the 60-second SMPS, you don't get that sort of resolution. So this is just one use case where faster scanning is not only possible, it is recommended, and you'll learn a lot more from a 60-second scan than when you would for a 5-second scan. Real-life situations where you're going to have a semi-transient aerosol that you'd care about, you could think of a jet plane taking off or somebody lighting up a cigarette or a truck driving by. These are all high-concentration, polydispersed aerosols that you're going to learn something with higher resolution. This is another look at that same data set and just what you would see in terms of a granularity. With the 5-second scanning SMPS, you can see that when it started to grow and when it started to plateau in terms of the geometric mean size as those soot particles from the toaster agglomerated and dissipated. Same thing with concentration versus time. You can see a little bit of ebbs and flows to what's going on where you get much poorer granularity. So faster scanning opens up some pretty neat possibilities for those who are interested in doing this. And in terms of kind of unprecedented resolution that you get while still having that using the SMPS principle of making measurements, which people rely on. So that brings us to the end of the presentation. Just in summary, we have a faster scanning SMPS and classifier that we've developed with enhanced usability and performance. Test methods and calibration methods comply with international and federal standards, and we have verified the performance of this classifier extensively against the 3080. Again, for more information on that testing, please refer you to the AAAR and European Aerosol Conference presentations that we gave. We've been shipping these instruments since October, and we are anxious to get these instruments into your hands so you can also build your own trust and reliance in this instrument as was done with the previous generation. Okay, so I'm going to take questions now, and you can go ahead and send me messages through the chat box if you like. If you have questions, I'll try to answer them. Okay, one question coming in about the relative humidity sensor and whether or not when this would be important for you as a user. Relative humidity is not something that we need to correct for in the airflow. The flow meter that we have has some sensitivity to relative humidity, but not a lot. So the relative humidity measurement that we make is for informational purposes only. We can still maintain our plus or minus 2% accuracy of flow rate over the entire temperature range and relative humidity range, even without without correcting the flow rate for it. So we still are plus or minus 2%. Relative humidity might be important if you are generating or sampling an aerosol that contains salt. And maybe you're getting close to the deliquescence point of your salt where you're going to start seeing some growth. Maybe your particles are hygroscopic, where they're taking on particles and you'll see growth. So that's in one case where you would care about the relative humidity. The upper size limit of the SMPS is the same as before. You can actually push it a little bit farther now, but not a whole lot. What we are specifying for the upper size limit right now is 1,000 nanometers, same as before. The soft X-ray is a question about what the level of radiation is from the soft X-ray. I don't know exactly, but I do know that it's lower than the Krypton 85 source, the 3077A. Okay, there's a question about DMA currents as far as that being on the diagnostics screen. And right now I think it's just a troubleshooting point. You might be able to see arcing as a result of if you're looking at the DMA current, although I'm not sure that the averaging and the resolution on the DMA, the diagnostic screen, would allow you to do that. But that is one thing that we kicked around in development testing, is whether or not we would have an arc counter that would count those. So maybe a feature for the future. The impactors were characterized, this question for Albert. Impactors were characterized, and the cutoff points are essentially the same as they were for the 3080. We did take validation data to look at how similar they are to the 3080. If you would like that information, you could send us an email. I'm not positive that we can release that just due to proprietary reasons, but they did not change, if that helps, although there might be slight differences. What I can say is the impactor flow rate calibration will be more precise now, if that helps, because they are you can switch them between classifiers for one, and our calibration method is more precise on them now. A question about retrace time. What was the purpose of having retrace time adjustable on the 3080? That's a very good question. I think, and somebody could correct me if I'm wrong, but I wonder if that is a bit of a legacy thing from the 3071 or some other embodiments of an SMPS where we considered, or people might have even used this in the past, not only data from the upscan, but also from the downscan. People have done that in the past, used data from the upscan and downscan to correct for that time delay between the DMA and the CPC. At this point, we understand time delay much better now, and in fact, we can scan all the way down to 5 or 10 seconds with just a 1% mismatch in size accuracy, which is pretty good. And so the retrace time now is very much legacy. Diffusion correction and multiple charge correction, a question about their usefulness. Diffusion correction corrects for particles, small particles, that are lost in transit between the inlet of the classifier and the CPC. And during development, we characterize what those losses are, dependent on not only particle size, but also flow rate. We would recommend the diffusion loss correction, if it's applicable in your application, for particles below 100 nanometers. The multiple charge correction, now both of these corrections are still used just like the 3080. You can still find them in the same place. You can still turn them on and off like you could before. The multiple charge correction is most useful for particles larger than 100 nanometers, where it's more likely to see a doubly charged particle, and it will remove or reduce the doublet peak in your or the multiply charged peak, which is to the left of your main peak. If you're looking at a model dispersed distribution, it will remove that and account for it. Okay, Nick, question about the effectiveness of the soft X-ray neutralizer and whether or not the effectiveness of the soft X-ray diminishes over time. That's a good question. No, the polonium-210 has a very short half-life, if I'm not mistaken, something like 180 days or so. The krypton source is, I think, around 15 years. The soft X-ray neutralizer has a lifetime where the neutralizer head will wear out. And so we log the number of hours that you've had your soft X-ray on when it's installed in the instrument. Actually, that's logged on the soft X-ray itself. So even if you run it outside of the instrument, we're still logging that. And then we'll flag you a warning once you cross, I think, around 3,800 hours. I could be wrong about that. It might be 8,000 hours. In any case, it's about a year of continuous use. So we allow you to turn off your soft X-ray. That's the nice thing about having it is it's you're not exposed to radiation when it's off. And we would recommend that you turn it off when not in use. When you reach that limit, it will let you know that you've reached kind of a stage where the X-ray head might die on you or might diminish in effectiveness or output. But there is a separate error for that. So it'll flag the warning when you've crossed that 8,000 hours, and it'll flag the error when your head finally does die. To date, we have only had one head in the last 3 years that I'm aware of die in the field. So they might very well last a lot longer than that 8,000 hours that we specify. I've got a lot of questions here, so I certainly appreciate them coming in, and I'll do my best to answer them. And we've got just a couple more minutes here. Hopefully you don't mind going a couple minutes over, and I'll try to answer them quicker. The time delay number in the new software, connection between the tube length and the DMA and the CPC, typically it was 10 inches or 25.4 centimeters. That is still the default tube length, but it is not the only tube length that you can do. You can put any tube length in there that you want, and we will account for it in terms of diffusion losses and in terms of time delay. It's one of the parameters that you enter when you're setting up an SMPS scan. A question about the accuracy of this new instrument in terms of accuracy at small particle sizes. Yes, we have that data, and if you want to request it, we can do our best to give you some information about its accuracy. We have that in our validation and verification testing, although we do not test size accuracy on particles other than 100 nanometers at calibration. But we've taken the data ourselves, yes. Maynard, thanks for chiming in here on the retrace time. Retrace time, Maynard says, was used to allow for more time for high concentration so it wouldn't carry over into the next scan. So the purge time that we specified now takes that place, and retrace is simply just getting back down to 0 volts. Thank you. There is an option to disable the diffusion of multiple charge corrections because in some cases it is not appropriate. Or maybe you want to see what your multiple charge peak looks like. If, for example, you are connecting, you're not using the classifier platform, then at least the diffusion correction wouldn't take into account the losses that we assume you have going through the classifier. Some people might connect directly to the DMA or might have another filter or bleed valve or something between the DMA and the CPC. So those would be cases where you might not want the diffusion correction enabled. How does fast scanning impact particle size resolution? I'm going to refer you to, I think, maybe my third to last slide, which shows a graph of geometric standard geometric size can't even remember the name of it right now, but anyways, a measurement of the breadth of the distribution and how that is affected by fast scanning. And that graph is just a couple of slides back here. I could probably click on it pretty quickly here. There we go. Geometric standard deviation, that was the word I was looking for. This is showing the breadth of it and how it changes with respect to faster scanning. This will be in your presentation that we send out. Okay, I think I have time for just one more question here, and then we're going to wrap it up. Appreciate your time. What advantages does dual charging polarity bring? So this instrument, maybe I didn't mention it, but one of the features is that we have both positive and negative polarity as an option when you order the classifier. That means internally we have both a positive supply and a negative supply. That means you can run with now, one of the advantages of that is that in ambient air, you'll find that there is slightly more, let's say 20% more, of one polarity than the other, which is kind of interesting. So it gives you those additional counting statistics. And then if you are doing studies where you want to see whether or not the setup that you are using to generate is generating more large or more positive or more negative, you can do that now with this dual charging polarity. Now, we had dual polarity, you have the potential of switching out the negative supply with the positive supply with the 3080, but it took some time, and you couldn't do scans back-to-back. Now you can. You can do back-to-back positive and then a negative scan if you wanted to in order to see the differences. Okay, I think with that I will wrap it up. It's a little bit after 12 p.m. our time, and I certainly appreciate you guys' attention, and I hope I've been able to answer your questions as well as give you a pretty good overview of what's going on here with the new SMPS. And we'll be sending this presentation out in a PDF form at the end of later this week, and you'll get that as a copy. If you have more questions, you can email me at jim.farnsworth@tsi.com. I'll go ahead and provide my email address here up on the screen, or you can email the organizer of this webinar as well for additional information. Okay, thank you for your time, and enjoy the rest of your day. Goodbye now.